And this is the Holy Gospel. It is according to St. Matthew. It begins in the 16th chapter, the 21st verse, and it reads, "From that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, 'God forbid it, Lord. This must never happen to you.' But he turned and said to Peter, 'Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things.' Then Jesus told his disciples, 'If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom.'" This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Well, grace to you all and peace from God our Creator and from Jesus Christ, our risen Lord and Savior. Amen. So today's gospel reading, the denial of Peter, when Peter gets rebuked. Just last week, Peter got the right answer. Peter, who do people say that I am? Oh, you're the Lord, you're the Messiah, you're the one who's got all the right answers. You're it, Jesus. And Jesus then says, yep, way to go, Peter. Good student. I'm going to build my church upon you, upon your rock, which Peter means rock. I'm going to build my church upon you, and the gates of hell, they're not even going to stand against it. And then immediately, in the next passage, what's Jesus do? Oh, and by the way, I'm going to go to Jerusalem. I'm going to be put on trial. They're going to kind of torture me. Oh, and by the way, I'm going to die. They're going to crucify me. Just, you know, a little side note for all you disciples. That's going to happen. And that's when Peter says, oh, no, 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 that can't happen, Lord. No way. And Jesus says, in this wonderful trick of the English of, well, not our language, but this wonderful trick, calls him. He says, you know what? Stop it, Peter. You are a stumbling block. So he goes from being the rock that the church is built on to a stumbling block. Still hard matter. And then he says, get behind me, Satan. Get behind me, adversary. Follow me. And then he goes on, and he gives some language that I think is amazingly powerful and terrifically confusing. For those who want to save their life are going to lose it, and those who lose their lives for my sake will save it. Take up your cross and follow me. Tough stuff. Take up your instrument of execution and follow me. Let's put it into our nice terms, our context. Take up your hangman's noose. Take up your firing squad. Take up your electric chair and follow me. Got a lump in your throat yet? Doesn't feel so good, does it? It's because it's tough. This past week at a tech study, a fellow pastor said something profound and brilliant. And I kind of went, wow. She said this to me. She said, you know, I think if you feel that following Jesus means you're comfortable, then you're probably not actually following Jesus. tough stuff, hard stuff, carrying your cross. I don't think it means carrying your cross means what some people have taken it to be, which is kind of a cliche, oh, I guess that's my cross to bear. Meaning, yep, I've had something bad happen in my life, I just got to live with it and move on. No, that's not what Jesus is getting at. Jesus is getting at, I think, taking risk. Martin Luther said something very profound in a way about this very same thing. And it was something all of us seminarians, when I learned it, loved to say. And we only wanted to say the first half because that was the funnest part. Because we'd quote Luther and we'd say, Luther said, when you sin boldly. And then we'd stop it right there. Because we'd all go, yay, hooray, we're going to sin, all right. Going to do it boldly with gusto. But it's actually a comma after it. When you sin boldly, but believe more boldly still. That's what Luther was getting at. Taking risks. Going forward. Following Jesus. Carrying the instrument of your execution. Let me tell you a story to see where I'm going, where I'm getting at. What it means to hold on to your life. Now, I've never done this, so I can't say whether it's been tested or not. But I remember when I was in school, second grade, I had this one told to me. A form of trap for a raccoon. And that is, you cut a hole in a can of food with maybe a quarter size hole on the top. You cut that hole in the top and you just leave it out, and a raccoon eventually will come along. It knows its food, will put its arm in there to reach in and grab it out, and won't let go. And because it's making its fist, trying to grab it, will not be able to pull its arm out. The only way they can pull it out is if they let go. And what's the nature of a raccoon? To not let go of the food. So if you do that, you'll see raccoons walking around with cans on their arms. Like I said, I've never tested it. I believe it to be true. But think about that. What is it that we hold on to that we're not going to let go, that unless we let it go, we're not going to move forward in life? Not moving forward in life, not moving forward in faith, not growing as God would have us to do. I think that's something different for just about everybody here, but maybe something the same. Yeah. Following Jesus, letting go of the food. Moving forward. Tough stuff. It really is. So what's it mean then to be saved? To lose our lives for Jesus' sake and to save it. When Emily worked in Chicago, she worked at Jewish Community Centers of Chicago, and at their building in Skokie, they had a fascinating mural. It was absolutely beautiful, mosaic, on the front of the building. And it's a verse from Deuteronomy. It had, of course, a bunch of people pictured from the community in this mosaic. And then it had down at the bottom flowing words, this flowing verse from Deuteronomy. And it was very simple. So that they may choose life. And what's it mean to choose life? It means to let go of that food in the can. Means to carry that cross. Means to let go. For life, so that they might live. I think the Old Testament lesson for this morning, the story of Moses encountering God, is very much about that. Remember, did Moses really want to go and save the Israelites? You sure, God? I think you might be able to find somebody who can speak better than me. But this Old Testament lesson, which Moses encounters God and he asks, "Who are you? What's your name?" And God responds, "I am." It's like God is Popeye. I am who I am. It's God's proper name, I am. It's the Hebrew verb, it's to be. What's the past tense, I was? It's a verb about existing. God is life in and of itself. But that's a choosing life story. So letting go of that food, resting on that baptism, that faith that we already have, and using it. I want to share a story with you, what happened last Saturday. And I think this kind of ties it all together. Using our faith as a gift given to us to venture forward. One of the things that Emily and I have started to do is we actually have communion at home, usually every Saturday night. We've started to do this with us three as our family supper before it happens. And last Saturday was pretty spectacular because the cup we used was a Cinderella cup of Astrid's with some apple juice in it. And, well, our bread was hot dog buns. And Astrid's not, she doesn't really have those words of institution down yet. She doesn't have, you know, this is the body of Christ given for you, this is the blood of Christ shed for you. So she ad-libbed. Instead of saying those words, she said, "This is the life of God. Isn't God nice?" Now, on its face, it's a cutesy story, but that's not where I'm getting at. Where I'm going is what does that mean? This is the life of God. Isn't God nice? Venturing forward, moving forward, letting go, taking up your cross, your death, will result in life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Amen.